I'm going to shake your doctrines. I'm going to confuse you so much that you're going to have to go back to the origin of your birth, which is Adam. And you're going to have to figure out some things. I don't want us to remain the same. More importantly, I don't want you to get to the end and realize you have wasted your living. And I'm not talking about wasting it on riotous living. I'm just talking about wasted your living, not understanding destiny and purpose. Is that fair? This is a time where we move. I was with some people recently this week, and they were sitting there and they were talking. We were talking about the home house and some other things. And they said, "Why are you here in Erie?" As if it was a bad place. I didn't want to answer that spiritually, because I would have told him, "I don't live here, I live in the kingdom." Now that's the spiritual answer I would have gave. But they wouldn't have understood that. Because no matter where you are, if you got kingdom, you can bring to you all that you need. But I said to them, I don't have the right to choose where I come and go. And they looked at me as if to say, what are you talking about? So I knew I had to go further. I said, I'm on an assignment. And I have been given an assignment by a council. And because of my covenant relationship with the council, I can't break the assignment. What, you some kind of special ops or something? The truth of the matter is, so are they. They just don't realize it yet. We don't have the right to pick and choose our going in and our coming out. He sets the order, and we have to follow it. So that really shook me, because I'm going through this word for today, and last night or yesterday evening, I just sat and had a talk with the wife regarding where we are, who we are, what we're doing, why we are here. But let the record show that Abundant Life, not Kevin, Denise, Abundant Life, will go down in history as a people who maintained their assignment and never gave up the land to the enemy. We're not going to permit, and I appreciate the prophetic words that were coming out today. We're not going to permit the strong man to overcome us. Amen. It's bigger than where you are. So this morning, just give me a few minutes. I need to give to you the counsel of the heavens for the day. I really believe it's going to be transformational. Some, you may not understand it, but if you start reading your scriptures according to what is said today, you're going to understand it. In fact, I'm back into the Word for another time, finding stuff that I've never seen before because of the revelation. Are you there? If you have your Bibles, I want to take you to a familiar scripture. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. In fact, for one of these verses, Pastor Gwen was sitting next to God himself when he wrote it. She remembers it. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 is where we're going to launch from today. Amen? There's a heaviness on me today, so just bear with me. It's not a bad heaviness. It's a kabod. Anybody know what kabod is? That's the glory. So, Father, I want you to bless our hearing today. Bless and anoint us as we sit in the heavens, as we receive counsel from you. We thank you for your power and your grace, the authority that you've given unto the children of men. Open our ears to hear what the Spirit says to the church, that we may be called out, that we might do great exploits. In the name of Jesus, we give you praise, honor, and glory. Amen. For the first 6 months of this year, we were to speak to you on faith to really help you develop your faith. We've done that. For the last 6 months of this year, there are three things that you will hear from the messages that come out of this pulpit: kingdom, covenant, and authority. All three of them are intertwined. God gives us the kingdom. Jesus himself has given us covenant through his blood, and the Holy Spirit has given us the release to walk in the authority. We're going to be working with that, and I'll bring that all together one day. But we're going to start today in this particular scripture, and our topic for today, everybody say the new creation.
The creation.
The kingdom of covenant believers. That's the subtitle. We're going to go to 2 Corinthians chapter 5, beginning at verse 14. For the love of Christ compels us, urges us, pushes us, because we judge thus, that if one died for all, then all died. And he died for all, that those who live should live no longer for themselves, but for him who died for them and rose again. How many of you know they're talking about Jesus? Amen. Therefore, this is so good. From now on, we regard no one, everybody say no one, according to the flesh. Even though we have known Christ according to the flesh, yet now we know him thus no longer. Man, that's peculiar. Can I go again? From now on, we regard no one according to the flesh. I want you to help me. No one. Don't y'all point at me. Come on. You. No one. According to the flesh. Even though we have known Christ according to the flesh, yet now we know him thus no longer. Therefore, I know what I just said, but let me just sum it up. Let me give you the quick version. This is what Paul is saying. If any man or anyone is in Christ, he is a
new creation.
He is a
new creation.
Old things have
passed away.
Already gone. Behold, all things have become
new.
All things have become
new.
So you're going to have to get rid of some old vision so that you can pick up the new. You can't see things the old way anymore. Okay? We have a rite of passage. What has brought us here is the labor that we have given in the Spirit to get to this place. Deep calleth unto deep, so we're going into deeper places. I want you to think about this when it comes to your business, when it comes to your home, when it comes to your relationships, everything that you do. We're going into a deeper place. Amen? Thank you, greeters. The new creation. This is a very peculiar passage, and it is specific when it says, "Now therefore, from now on, we regard no one according to the flesh." For those of you who don't understand the term flesh, it is the natural sense of something, something that is soulish. I always tell everyone, drop the H, spell it backwards, you get self. It is the ooh of you. It's not who you are, but it's the ooh of you. It's just that stuff. In the scriptures, it says it's the psuche, which means the natural mind, how you do things, how you think things. And we take that and we actually possess it, meaning everything that we do is based on the natural mind. But that's not what God has called you to. My word and your word says that the earth is the Lord's and the... When God created the earth, he gave order to it. I hear people talk about evolution, the Big Bang theory, things of that nature. But that's the foolishness of men who have yet to come to know intimately the true God. But God has set things in the heavens and they do not change. Now we have seen time and systems change because of the disorder that we have permitted in the earth. In fact, sometimes you have snow in summer, but that's because of disorder. But when you go back to order, the seasons are the seasons. You will live here in this region because you know when summer is done, spring is on its way. I'm sorry, when winter's done, spring's on its way. When spring is done, summer's on its way. Y'all know what I'm talking about. You have hope that you ain't got to live in the ice, in the cold, for the rest of your life. Is there a witness today? Amen. You understand that. There's a flow. You understand that God has given us signs. He's given us times. He's given us seasons. And when God created the earth, he created it in perfection. Let me just go to another place. I wasn't born in 1800s. I wasn't born in the 1700s. I literally were born in the 1900s, 61 to be exact. I came at the perfect time, the perfect day, to the perfect family. Are you there? Perfect. Perfect family. You say your family was that good. No, my family wasn't that good because they had nothing to do with creating me. In fact, I came 10 months after my brother. My family had nothing to do with that. Are you there? I was on time, I was in time, according to the purpose and the plans of God. Are you there? Now, yes, my dad left home. We didn't have a dad. In fact, he stuck around for 3 years, and he became a rolling stone, not understanding some things that he needed to know about himself. And I don't hold nothing. That's my dad. Are y'all there? And when I get to heaven, y'all gonna meet him too. I mean, great man as far as I'm concerned. If the tree was good, so is the fruit. Okay, he just didn't know who he was in Christ Jesus. Are y'all there? So I don't squawk, but my God knew that dad was going to take off one particular day and something would come out of me. And praise the name of the Lord, I didn't pick up perhaps some principles and doctrines that might have been instilled in him that would have caused me to run in the wrong way. Are you there? So I'm content with where I'm at, in the fact that God orders time. God orders seasons. I know you, you know me. We are here. I'm not trying to rush somewhere else. I hope you're not. It's hard when relationships run away from you. You like to keep relationship. You know, that's our greatest resource. You miss people when they run and they got to do other things. Even when they're on assignment, you miss them. Everybody follow me? So God orders times and seasons. He puts together everything. In fact, outside of our church right now, stay with me. I need you to get the picture. You walk outside, there's some red, there's some yellow, there's some green, there's some black bark. You got all these flowers that were created, not by man. He tries to hybrid everything. But listen, God created some things and brought grace to us So it is good to wake up and see some flowers during the day. Are you with me? There's another scripture that says, look at the birds of the air, for they neither sow nor reap, nor gather in barns, yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Matthew 6:26. Okay? He goes on to say, are you not of more value than they? Yeah. Hear the word of the Lord, Galatians 1:16. For by him, as Jesus, all things were created that are in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones, and you need to hear this, or dominions, or principalities, or powers, all things were created through him and the God we serve has created everything. There is nothing above him. Everything is beneath his world because he is literally the creator of the creation. Are you there today? It's another scripture I want you to see out of Psalm 19, verse 1. The heavens declare the glory of God. Now, we see the heavens all the time. They declare the glory of God, and the firmament shows his handiwork. I love when I'm on a plane going somewhere, and they just riding above the clouds. And you look out, and you see the vast glory of God. And sometimes you're wondering if you can get out and just step on it. Man, that's so rich. If you've not been there, you want to go there. In fact, some of you know I'm working on my pilot's license, and I love to go up over the peninsula when in my training. And when you're up over the peninsula, it's better than being on the peninsula. You get to see the glory. You can see the whole peninsula just in one watch. You know, you get to drive around and you get the detail, but I love seeing it in a watch. But to be up in a place, now where am I going with this? Listen, when you sit in heavenly places, there are things that you can see that nobody else can see. One. Two, in heavenly places, it's far above all principalities, powers, rulers of darkness, spiritual wickedness. Are you there? I'm talking about the new creation. Verse 2, day unto day utters speech, and night unto night reveals knowledge. There is no speech nor language where their voice is not heard. Their line has gone out through all the earth, and the words to the end of the world. There's another scripture said that the trees clap their hands. You say, well, how can trees clap their hands? They continue to speak of the glory of God. So when God set creation, I want you to catch this, he set it according to balance. In fact, some of you will read your Bibles, and if you read the term of God in your Bibles, most of your Bibles, it'll say Lord, L, capital L-O-R-D, small case letters, Lord, capital L, capital O-R-D. It'll say God. It'll say Lord God. And I've been researching all of the different terms and how God's doing and how God's names have come up differently. Well, primarily, I'll go for the Lord. When you see the term Lord, Lord was not used until primarily the second verse after the creation was done. And when he used the term Lord God, Lord speaks of his mercy. So God brought in his mercy. So it says the Lord God formed Adam in the garden and speaks of his mercy, Lord. When you see the term God, God speaks of his balance. In the beginning, God. God says, I'm going to balance some things. The devil done got in here and he done messed up some stuff. The whole earth is full of water. It's void. Darkness is upon the face of the deep. And God balanced everything. That's a little bit of Bible study. Is that all right? Okay. So here, God is a God of balance. Because of who God is, he does not submit or respond to the will of men, but he responds to the glory of his word. Are you there? Yesterday, Denise and I, we were sitting down. We had ordered this really good turkey avocado wrap while we were out of town, and a young lady brought it to us, and the waitress decided to sit down and talk to us. How many of you know that was our first blessing? The second blessing came when we began to just release some things, but she sat down and she started to talk to us. Her name was Annabelle, and parents from weren't born in this country, and we sat and we talked, and as she talked, and I said, "What is your religious orientation?" That's a kind way of saying what denomination you are. And she says, "Yeah, we're Roman Catholics." And she said, "But I don't believe in the Roman Catholic Church and all that they're doing." I said, "How so?" So she began to go on and talk now. When she began to go on and talk, she says, "Well, I believe that anybody should be able to love who they want to love." And I said, "Well, what are you saying?" And she says, "Well, I don't believe that the Roman Catholic Church is correct in telling people who to marry. You should be able to love who you want to love." I said, "You know what? I so agree with you." I said, "But that's not the order that God put it in." And she went on and on and on, and I stopped her and I said, "Can you tell me, what does God think about all of that?" And she came back and said, "Well, God doesn't agree with that." We never saw her for the rest of the day. She never brought our bill back. We had to get another waitress. But she left me with one thing, her name. That's all I needed. So when we walked out of that place, we took time till we got in the car and drove off the lot. We were praying for Annabelle. Why? Because God's going to do a new work in Annabelle. That's why we were sent there. We weren't sent there to go get a turkey avocado wrap. We were sent there to pray for Annabelle. And we got to expound some things for Annabelle. And she looked at Denise, and Denise said, "I'm 55. And she thought Denise was much younger. She said, "Boy, I want to look like that when I get that age." She was only, I don't know, she's in her 20s or something. 22, yeah. But she had all the knowledge of some things, but she missed what God is doing. God will not respond to what man thinks. And some of us got some stuff in our head that we think that God's not responding to. You ever start praying and wondering why he's not answering your prayers? If you got to wonder why he's not answering your prayers, you're on the wrong level. You have not fixed yourself on the things that God has given you. Are you there? So God wants you to understand his plans and his purposes according to what he has destined for you and his purpose for you in your life. Now, let me just go back to that issue just for a second. I'm quitting. I don't have a problem with homosexuals. They ain't no different than heterosexuals that are outside the box. You're not supposed to do that till you get married. They're no different. Sin is sin. But we are not, as a body, to know any man after the flesh. Y'all get nervous about all this stuff. Don't speak to the man flesh, speak to his spirit. When you start talking to a spirit, how many know you're gonna change some things? The light dispels the darkness. When you start knowing who you are, hear me. When you start knowing who you are, your future will possess more victories than your past. When you understand the release of the love of God towards you, you will have stuff that you have never possessed before. And that's where we have to go. Paul says out of 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 23, "I pray your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved blameless." We've missed that scripture in understanding what it is. We think that we are a spirit, we are a soul, and we have a body. That's not what that says. When you get into it and you read it, we are spirit. Man is a spirit. The flesh that you see here is only what you get to see so that you can understand me. Are you there? Inside, I am a spirit. You are a spirit. So when you start looking the wrong way at folk, you've missed who they are. When you start seeing yourself according to the flesh, you miss who you truly are. Are you there? We've been designed to be spirit. It's not what's on the inside of you. Don't look at it like that. It is who you are. Somebody say, I am a spirit.
I am a spirit.
You are a spirit. You live inside of a body. When the body goes away and decides to decay, the spirit doesn't decay. The spirit moves on. You get a new body later on. Are you there today? You can perceive and communicate with the exterior realm because you have a body, and you do that through your soul, your mind, your will, your emotions. In fact, in Genesis chapter 2, verse 7, the word says, "And the Lord God formed man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his," come on everyone, the what? The breath of life. And man became, well, in the Aramaic translation, it says man became a speaking spirit. Never before done. Man became a speaking spirit. In other words, we were born like God in the sense that when God created us, he created us out of his breath, and we are a speaking spirit. He just formed something around us so we can communicate with one another. Are you there today? As the natural man sees, hears, and perceives the material world, the spirit man can see, hear, and perceive the spiritual world. Are you there? When you understand that you are spirit, you automatically eliminate issues, problems that cause you to deter yourself from walking in the spirit. The spirit man lives in a realm, when it's submitted to God, higher than any other system of this world. Poverty is a system. Fear is a system. Governments are system. The spirit man lives in a realm called the kingdom of God that is higher than any other realm in this world. And we are struggling because we are trying to live naturally from a spirit realm. You can't do that. You have to be in the spirit and walk in the spirit that you don't fulfill the lust of the flesh. Before Christ, our spirit is only awake to the spiritual world of darkness. But you are dead to God because of sin. When you are walking before Christ, your spirit man is awake, but it's dead to God. But it's awake to the spiritual world of darkness. What Satan runs, not what God runs. That twisted, that distorted stuff we talked about last week. Are you with me today? But after Christ, our spirit comes alive, and now we are open to the revelation through the light of God. That's what revelation is. God shines his light and revelation comes. The word of the Lord says out of John chapter 1, verse 4. In him was life, and the life in him was the light of men. In other words, we get to walk in revelation because of the life of Christ that lives inside of us. Are you there today? So no longer can you walk like you did yesterday. Well, I'm saved now. I'm saved. Well, what does that mean? You got to grow in that. You can't just be saved. You have to grow in the fact of who you are in your salvation. I'm looking forward to this. And you say, well, preacher, you've been around a long time and you're looking forward. I'm looking forward to this because there's new revelations that are coming. And I want to get into that. I want to walk that out because I haven't walked on water yet. Peter did. Are you there? I haven't seen Lazarus raised from the dead yet after 3 to 4 days. I'm going to see that. I don't know where you're going, but I'm going to see that. Are you there? I haven't seen a group of people fed for 40 years while manna's raining from heaven. Okay? You say what you will, but this is where we're going. I ain't trying to die. I'm trying to live. Are you there? In fact, who was it? It was Jacob when he stood before Pharaoh. He said, who are you and how old are you? He said, I'm not as old as my parents. He was complaining. He felt dishonored by that. The man was 135 years old. He said, I ain't lived long as my dad's. I ain't lived long as Isaac. I ain't lived long as Abraham. 135 years old. I'm going to live longer than my parents. Are you there? Unless God got some martyr work going on, we living. Somebody say, we're going to live and not die. So when you understand the power of the Spirit can keep you alive. You can speak to the flesh because it is a system beneath the spirit man. And when the spirit man locks with God, it becomes like God. Adam spent time in the garden every day with God. He was like God. So hear the word of the Lord out of the New Testament. 1 Corinthians 6:17. But he who is joined to the Lord is one with him. One spirit. That means we know God intimately. That means we can hear his voice. That means the spirit man is fully tuned into the spirit world. I know the going in and know the coming out. All because we're in tune with God. I've walked in stores, I won't call them, in the mall. And I've walked in, and Apostle Denise knows me well. She's with me. I said, honey, nope, let's go. And I turn right back around. Because in those places are operating stuff that I don't need to be involved with. Neither will I give what has been bestowed upon me to something that doesn't belong in the kingdom. Are y'all there? Now, I'm not talking about some of those stores you walk in, like Spencer's or what, where they got stupid stuff and crazy stuff. And there's stuff that looks good. You know, Satan comes as an angel of light. But your spirit man ought to be able to detect what's going on. Now, if I had to go in that store to get something and I had to spend money there, then I would do it. But if I'm just browsing, I don't have to do it. Now, I know what's new, but everything new is nice. But that don't mean I had to be a part of it. Are you there? Why? Because we operate out of our spirit man. Are you there? So you get to know some things, and sometimes you'll be able to walk up to people who look like they've been to hell and back 50 times, and they have nothing going for themselves, but you can see the Spirit of Christ down and through them. In fact, there are times that you can look so far into them, you can see the generational blessings that need to be drawn out of them. Are you there? They don't understand it. They don't know it because they don't know themselves as a spirit, but there's a generational blessing that's on them that can be drawn out of them. Somebody say, I am a spirit. We have to stop working to know who we are in the natural. I need to know my identity. You know, whether I'm a fireman, policeman, attorney. We're trying to obtain something in the natural when what we need to learn to do is to walk in the spirit. I got rebuked by the Lord, and I'm going to share it with you. We've been rewarding the kids for their grades. God had no problem with that at all. But parents, your kids are accelerating in education, but they don't understand the work of the Spirit. I remember when my son was up in his church at the age of 3, praying for people. And healing was developing. And then he went to school. Man, I missed it. He went to school. And he started seeing people around him, so he was growing more in the natural. But there's a root in him. And he's out of the box anyway, so I'm okay with that. I'm okay with that. So, but there's a root in him, and he's going to go places. I know that. He thinks he's looking for his identity. He gonna find it. He gonna find it. I'm gonna tell you why he's gonna find it. Because that's my son. He's under this authority. And when you know who you're under and know who you walk with, you're gonna find it. Abraham wasn't worried about Isaac. Isaac wasn't worried about Jacob. Jacob was not worried about Joseph. They found what they needed to do. Are you there? Somebody say, my child's gonna find it. The kingdom realm that I'm taking you to, it's higher than every other system. In the kingdom realm, you live on another level. You have the fruit of the Spirit. You have grace that bounds towards you. The greater the deposits that you put into the kingdom realm, the greater the wealth that comes out of it. You literally can speak to systems when you are walking joined to Christ. You can overthrow these systems. Stay with me. You don't have the money you need for something, and you're trying to figure out where it comes from. Well, you don't get your money from the Spirit when you're in the Spirit, from the natural realm. You get it out of the spiritual realm. And you come and you speak out of the spirit realm what you need. Lord, I have given and it's given unto me. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over. It will come as you believe, because you can't believe from a natural place. You have to believe from a spiritual place. So as you walk in the Spirit, there's some things that you have to know. Sometimes when I'm doing some things, somebody say, well, what are we going to do this, or where are we going with it? Don't know yet. What are you waiting on? Don't know yet. I leave it right there. Do I need to know? Absolutely not. I'll have it when it's time. I don't have to rush God, because when you move in the Spirit, you know who's in charge. And all you have to do is walk. Are you there? But we do have a responsibility to speak to other systems and to tear down those other systems that have come against you. Now, if these systems have come against your marriage, don't talk to your spouse. That's the craziest thing to do. You might lose your spouse. Things may go belly up. And then you'll start blaming God for the marriage. I'll say amen. But if you go into the spirit realm, and Andy, I so appreciate that word you gave at the end of worship today. The whole earth groaneth for the manifestation of the sons of God. When you speak to the spirit realm, you can shut down systems. Are y'all with me today? Somebody was speaking on poverty today. You shut down systems when you start speaking from the spirit realm. God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of I declare power, love, and a sound mind on us. I declare that. You begin to speak from that. And you know, I'm taking my authority on this. Why? Because I'm the spirit man. Hear the word of the Lord, Revelations 11, 15. The seventh angel sounded. Seventh angel sound. This is when we get our completion. And there were loud voices in heaven saying, this is what they were saying, the kingdoms of this world have become the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever. Now, hold that scripture up there. Now, I want you to understand something. When we're joined with Christ, listen, it's not you that's talking. It's the spirit of Christ in you that's shutting those kingdoms down. We're trying to take power and authority. You know, well, who do I need to talk to? I don't need to talk to anybody but God. Sometimes you just got to stand flat-footed and say, no, it's not going to happen that way. No, it's not going to be that way. No, we're not going to tolerate that. And you got to push back the darkness. The darkness can't stay where it is. It is subject to the kingdom of God. So God is looking for his sons, daughters as well. That's the same word. It's a plural term. To rise up and say, oh, no, oh, no. By the words out of my mouth, you cannot overtake this place. But you have to come into the realm where you understand the fullness of your identity. That is, I am a spirit, and I worship God in spirit and in truth. I have a right to get my praise on. I have a right to lift up holy hands. I have a right to speak forth the things of God. I have a right to take the territory and to push things back. If things are faltering, it's all because we brought in another system. And under any other system, everything will crumble. But when we bring the kingdom back and understand that I stand in covenant with a mighty God, and there is no, everybody say no, weapon can form against us. Everything that rises will be condemned. Why? Because we walk in the spirit and not in the flesh. The devil's got the church all discombobulated, being all concerned. Well, should we speak in tongues? Should we not speak in tongues? What? You know who you are. I don't want to do that. You know, you don't know what you're saying? No. You shouldn't know what you're saying. I'll tell you why. Eye has not seen, neither ear heard, neither has entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for those that love him. Natural people can't catch that. You're not going to catch that when you walk in the natural. But it says in verse 10, but God has revealed them to us through his spirit. For the spirit searches all things, yea, the deep things of God. Not in the natural world. The spirit searches the deep things of God through the supernatural world. The spirit world. You got all of our children who are rising up in the world systems today, and now they're trying to grab hold of what spiritual things that they think they know. They're crying out for the spirit world. And the only thing they have, because they're not saved, is the spiritual darkness that's out there. So they're grabbing hold of the occult and things like that, searching for who they really are, because their spirit man can't understand it. It's dead to them. The word of the Lord says, I believe it's verse 14, the natural man does not receive the things that are of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him. Neither can he, come on everyone, intimately know them because they are what? Spiritually discerned. They're struggling. They're struggling. They're struggling. They're struggling. Why? Because their flesh is only alive. Their spirit has yet to come alive. But when you get your spirit man rolling, you know something. Stay with me just for a moment. Are you there? Anybody out there, just say amen.
Amen.
Listen, the Bible says the flesh wars against the spirit and the spirit against the flesh. There's an internal war that's inside of you that you're troubled with because your old wants to take over the new. But you got to tell the old, no, you're shutting down today. I'm mortifying you. We're not going to tolerate you today. Oh, no. I told Denise this past week, I said, my flesh does not want to make this trip down to Virginia because I had to go down and turn around and come back. I said, my flesh didn't want to do it. But I said, I'm going to do it because my spirit man wants me to go. And I did go. I had more energy coming back. I thought, I got back after 12 last night. I thought, I'm going to get up late. I got up earlier than I ever do. Glory to God. When you put the spirit man in charge, the spirit man will run you where you need to be. Are you there? So the flesh will war against the spirit. Listen to me. The flesh will war against the flesh. There is among you fightings. Why? Because flesh is running up against flesh. Why? Don't ever battle that. Never fight the flesh with the flesh. That's a war. That's not of God. Spirit will strive with spirit. That's why in God's kingdom, it's always peace. There's always grace. Because when you operate out of your spirit and you know no man after the flesh, you literally owe nobody but love. Are y'all there? When you start spending time with God, and walking in your spirit, man. I'm not talking religious. You read your Bible all day long. You can pray religious prayers all day long. But when you operate from that of a spirit realm, and you understand that I'm in the spirit with God, and I have the same power and authority to operate and to rule and to reign as he has called me, there's a favor that walks with you. When you understand that favor, it literally overthrows every other kingdom that is out there. Somebody say, I got the favor of the Lord. So God's trying to reveal to you the full measure, not partial, full. Stop saying, oh, I made this mistake. I've made this mistake. Why do you remind yourself of your mistakes? What is that? Okay. Oh, it's under the blood. Did you ask God for forgiveness? Yeah, put it under the blood. And you're constantly reminding people of your mistakes. That's you drawing on your past. Don't let Satan do that to you. Draw on who you really are. No? I'm a king in the kingdom. I'm a priest in the kingdom. And what I lay down is what's going to be laid down according to the measure of Christ. Are you with me? I'm going to give you one final scripture, and I want you to feast on this. You can go home with this one. Matthew chapter 15. Are y'all with me today?
Amen.
Verse 22. And behold, a woman of Canaan came from that region, Canaan region. Now, those of you who don't understand Canaan, Canaan was, let me put it in correct terms for today. They were Christian folks who were walking like the world. How's that? And cried out to him, saying, have mercy on me, O Lord. Y'all see the Lord? Son of David. My daughter is severely, come on everybody. Some of y'all kids be having demons. Y'all don't do nothing about it. You let that demon run, and then 10 years later, that demon's still there. And that kid has gotten used to that demon after 10 years. Y'all need to cast that thing out of him. I used to love Apostle Shirley Brown. Her grandkids used to come in the house and they have a spirit on them. She said, honey, come here. I don't know what spirit you got in here, but I'm going to ask you to go back out that door, get rid of that spirit, and come back in here the right way. I mean, you know, that ought to happen with us. We let our kids just run rampant because we don't know who we are. But here, this woman got a demon-possessed kid in verse 23. But he answered her not a word. I love Jesus. And his disciples came and urged him, saying, send her away, for she cries out after us. Why? Because she was a Samaritan. She don't belong among us. She a Samaritan. She shouldn't be hanging out with us. Look, we're the Jews. Who is this woman? Man, if that's not religion, if that's not division, who are these people? She from some other part of the world. But he answered and said, I was not sent except to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Now, I want you to notice his response. He said to her, I was not sent to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. He was trying to pull out where she was in the faith. She was not concerned about his answer. He was teaching a lesson to his disciples. All they saw things were is in the natural, Israel. So he says, I was not sent to the lost sheep. Are y'all there? Verse 25. Then she came. Come on, everybody. Oh, listen. She stepped out of the natural and moved into the spirit. She worshiped him. Are y'all there? Then she came and worshiped him, saying, Lord, help me. But he answered and said, it is not good to take the children's bread and throw it to the little dogs. And she said, yea, Lord. Even the little dogs eat the crumbs which are from the master's table. She stayed in the spirit. I may not have all that they have, but I got something. I got faith like a mustard seed, Lord. He said in verse 28, then Jesus answered and said to her, O woman, come on, everybody.
Great is your faith.
What kind of faith?
Great is your faith.
Let it be to you as you desire. And her daughter was healed that very hour. She understood the hierarchy of the kingdom. So you know what? She walked in her favor. Oh, no, this is mine. You're not taking mine from me. Absolutely not. I'm coming after you. If we are not willing to sacrifice all that we have, I think we sung that this morning, that alabaster box, and bring it in and lay it before the Lord and come back and roll in the spirit, then we are literally putting ourselves below who we are. We have to go back to walk in the spirit. Oh, no, we're not going to put up this. We will. We will win. Tell your neighbor, we will win. Tell somebody else, we will win. You have to make a choice today. You got to go to the next level. You got listen. I am not going to let that. You got to tell yourself, I'm not going to let that devil let me see myself as someone who failed. I am not a failure. Tell your neighbor, you're not a failure. Oh, no. Listen, you can't see your neighbor as a failure. Now, your neighbor may be crazy. Your neighbor may be all mixed up. Your neighbor may be talking jibber-jobber and foolishness all the time. But don't you focus on that, you know? You got to say, remember who you are. Sometimes my wife, she tells me off sometime, and I say, hold it, hold it. That's why I say, hold it. I may be wrong, but I don't say that. I say, hold it. Do you know that I'm a king? And she looked at me, and she said, now, I know she knows, but I just reminded her. And she walks away from me. Got out of that one. Sometimes I want to deal with her because my wife is a true Eve before the fall. Man, everything was in place. It's got all in place. My wife don't ask me about budget. I don't even know if she can spell the word. It's not even in her vocabulary. But she comes, honey, I just went and bought this. Make sure you take care. I bought this, I bought that, I bought that. But where is this woman getting all this money? She understands kingdom. I had to come to the understanding because, you know, I'm the budgeter. So I've learned to go back. Lord, we just decree and set decrees over my finances. We cause the river to swell, Lord. Are y'all there? Y'all think we got it like that. We may not have it manifested, but we decreeing it. And for some reason or another, the river's always swelling to meet the needs of what she done already spent. So she... Yes, always. She's teaching me to operate in another realm by her spending. Now, don't y'all take that for granted. do you understand what I'm saying? All right, you just don't just do that. It's the way we got something going on here. But what I understand is there's a place of faith that God is taking us to in our spirit, man. And the only way we get there is to be tried in the fire. No fire, you don't get there. But you need to be tried in the fire. Tell your neighbor, we're going. Come on to your feet. Tell them we're going. Come on, give God praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So when Apostle Kevin says, hey, we're going to pray in the spirit, listen, we're going to pray in the spirit because our spirit man understands the revelation. Our spirit man is communing with God. The natural man can't do that. The spirit man can. So we can pray in the spirit, and you say, well, you don't understand it. No, but our spirit understands. Let me tell you something. I got to go here. Let me tell you, when you're moving in the spirit, and you're praying in the spirit, and you're doing some things, the spirit man, which is over all other systems, y'all believe that? Do you believe that? Okay, listen. The spirit man literally can take your feet places where you've never thought you've been before. The spirit man can take your feet, can take your mind, listen, can take your thoughts into things that you've never seen before. Take your imaginations where God wants you to see like you've never seen before. But that only happens when you operate out of the spirit. When you want to teach your kids something, you got to teach them how to operate out of the spirit. Dad, mom, I don't understand all this. I don't know what's going on. I don't understand. You ain't got to understand it, son. Just come on and operate in it. Come on, pray with me. I ain't asked you to understand. I'm just asking you to walk the walk of obedience. That's why we speak about obedience so much. Why? Because in obedience, our blessings come. Why? We're just moving in the spirit because we haven't understood that life yet. But how many of you know we're going there? How many of you know we're going there? We are going there. Come on, give him praise today. Hallelujah.